Most welcome to lecture number 13 of my series on Introduction to Complex Analysis. In my previous lecture, I discussed about complex line integral, Cauchy's theorem, and Cauchy-Gaussat theorem. If you have not watched that video, I advise you to watch that one before you start watching this one. The link is in the description below, and you can see above as well. In this video, I shall discuss about Cauchy-Gaussat theorem in multiply connected regions and some important consequences of Cauchy-Gaussat theorem, which will be instrumental in further development of the subject. Let us first read out the statement of Cauchy's theorem and Cauchy-Gaussat theorem, which you can see on your screen. Cauchy's theorem states that if fz is analytic with derivative f prime z being continuous at all points inside and on a simple closed curve C, as you can see in the picture, then integration of fz dz along this curve C will be equal to zero. Now, in Cauchy-Gaussat theorem, the restriction that f prime z needs to be continuous has been relaxed, and it has been proved that if fz is analytic at all points inside and on a simple closed curve C, then integration of fz dz along C is equal to zero. So Cauchy-Gaussat theorem is obtained from Cauchy's theorem by relaxing the constraint that a prime z needs to be continuous, which you can see in Cauchy's theorem. Now, I shall introduce the concept of simply connected region and multiply connected region. A region R is called simply connected if any simple closed curve which lies in R can be shrunk to a point without leaving R. As an example, let us consider the two diagrams. If you look at the region R1, which is in the left side of your screen, and if you consider the curve C1 within R1, then you can easily understand that you can shrink C1 to a point without leaving the region R1. But if you consider the annular region R2, which is in the right side of your screen, and if you consider the curve C2 in the region R2, then you can easily understand that you cannot shrink this curve C2 to a point without leaving the region or the annular region R2. So as per the definition, this R1 is a simply connected region, but this R2 is not a simply connected region. Now, a region which is not simply connected is known as a multiply connected region. Hence, R1 is a simply connected region and R2 is a multiply connected region. In our previous discussion, you can very easily understand that we have proved Cauchy's theorem, and we discussed about Cauchy-Gaussat theorem for any simple closed curve in a simply connected region. Now let us see whether Cauchy-Gaussat theorem holds in a multiply connected region or not. So our first agenda of this tutorial will be to prove Cauchy-Gaussat theorem for a multiply connected region. Let us consider the multiply connected region, which is a kind of this annular region, like this, something like this. And let us consider that there is a function fz which is analytic on this region. Let us denote this region by R, and the two simple closed curve within which this region is bounded, let us name them as C1 and C2. let me quickly remind you that the positive direction of a curve is that direction which keeps the region in the left side when a person traverses along that curve being perpendicular on the plane. So in that sense, the positive direction of the outer simple closed curve C1 will be counterclockwise because the region is in the left side in that sense, in that direction. And when you consider the inner simple closed curve, then the positive direction should be the clockwise direction because only in that case, the region R will be in the left side if a person traverses along the curve in that direction being perpendicular to the plane. So that's why the two arrowheads are placed in that way. So this is my region R. These are the two simple closed curve. And my function fz, I have a function fz which is analytic on this region R. Now, any multiply connected region can be converted to a simply connected region if you consider or if you construct a crosscut in the region. For example, here, let us consider a crosscut. Let us consider a crosscut this. Suppose I'm cutting this region by a scissor along this straight line. And now, let us give some names. So let us consider that this point is my, A. Here I have this portion is, say, B. Here I have a point, say, C. Here I have a point, say, D. Here I have a point, say, E. This point, say, consider as F. Here I have a point, say, G. Here I have a point, say, H. And here I have a point, say, I. So this, let us consider I have these points in my, on my curves, on the two curves. So this, and this AF this A to F is a crosscut. Now the region bounded by the simple closed curve A, B, C, D, E, A, F, G, H, I, F, A is a simply connected region. Hence, by Cauchy-Gaussert theorem, which is discussed earlier for simply connected regions, we can conclude that integration of fz along this simple closed curve A, B, C, D, E, A, F, G, H, I, F, A will be equal to zero because this is a simply connected region bounded by this simple closed curve C on and within which the function is analytic as per our assumption. So by Cauchy-Gaussert theorem, we can conclude that this integration will be zero. Now, this integration can be written as, if we consider this curve, a sum of these four line integrals. Now, if you look at these two line integrals carefully, you can understand that integration of fz dz along AF is equal to negative of integration of fz dz along FA. And if we introduce this equality in the above equation, we get integration fz dz along A, B, C, D, E, A plus integration fz dz along F, G, H, I, F is equal to zero. Now you can understand that this is nothing but our outer simple closed curve C1, and this is nothing but our inner simple closed curve C2. So just look above. Yes, this is A, B, C, D, E, A. That is outer curve C1, and F, G, H, I, F. That is our inner simple closed curve C2. So this is equal to zero, which we can write alternatively as integration of fz dz along this curve, say I am giving a name, say C star is equals to 0. What is C star? Where C star defines the complete boundary of R. Now keep in mind that the boundaries are to be traversed in the sense that an observer working on the boundary always has the region R on his left. That means if we look at the region, that is, the observer should traverse according to the arrowheads that you can see in the diagram. That means the region should lie always in the left side. So what do we have got? We have got that if I have a function fz defined on this multiply connected region where the boundaries are c1 and c2, as you can see here, then integration of fz dz along this complete boundary will be equal to 0. So this is the version or the extension of Cauchy-Gaussert theorem in a multiply connected region. Now, as an immediate corollary, we have the following proposition. Let fz be analytic in a region bounded by two simple closed curves, c1 and c2, and also on these curves. Then integration fz dz along c1 will be equal to integration fz dz along c2, where c1 and c2 are both traversed in positive sense relative to their interiors. This is the most important thing. Where c1 and c2 are both traversed in positive sense, relative to their interiors. That means if I try to represent them in a diagram, let us see how the thing will look like. So let us consider that the pink dotted region is my region which is referred there, bounded by the two simple closed curves, C1 and C2. I have chosen C1 to be the outer curve and C2 to be the inner curve. Now, can you identify or can you think what will be the positive sense for the two curves, C1 and C2? Now, remember, C1 and C2 are both to be traversed in positive sense relative to their interiors. That means if an observer is traversing along these two curves, always should have the interior of these two curves in the left side. So naturally, for the outer curve, the positive sense will be this along this direction, because the interior is lying in the left. If the observer traverses along this direction, now the most important point. Can you tell me for the inner curve, what will be the positive sense relative to interior? Remember, the interior of C2 is not the region R. The interior of C2 is actually the portion which is inside, which is within the curve C2. So keeping that in mind, positive sense for C2 will also be the same. That is the key point in this proposition. Now, if you ask me how this can be proved, pretty simple. Already we have proved this proposition in the Cauchy-Gaussert theorem for multiply connected region. If you look at the arrowheads of the multiply connected region that we took in Cauchy-Gaussert theorem, you can understand the how the theorem in this case can be proved. So here is the direction, positive sense for C1. Here is the positive sense for C2. Now, if we implement Cauchy-Gaussert theorem, then we can write for this region R, we can write that integration of fz dz along C1 plus minus of integration of fz dz along C2 will be equal to 0. Why I have taken this minus? Because you know that when I consider minus of integration fz dz along C2, that means my direction is actually the clockwise direction, means the direction will be the positive direction relative to the region R, which is what we have proved in case of Cauchy-Gaussert theorem for multiply connected regions. And this actually implies integration of fz dz along C1 is equal to integration of fz dz along C2. That's pretty simple. It's just a simple observation from Cauchy-Gaussert theorem. So whenever both are traversed in the positive sense relative to their interiors, both the integrations will have the same value. And believe me, this is a hugely important theorem with lots of application we will see immediately in the next sections. Now, this theorem can be further generalized as, let fz be analytic in a region bounded by the non-overlapping simple closed curves C, C1, C2, etc., Cn, where this C1, C2, C3, etc. up to Cn are inside C, as you can see in the figure below. And also fz is analytic on each of these curves. Then integration fz dz along C is equal to the sum of integration fz dz along each of these curves individually. So this is a simple generalization of the previous proposition. Now, let us discuss some important consequences of Cauchy-Gaussert theorem. The first one is extremely useful and states that if fz is analytic in a simply connected region R, then integration a to b fz dz is independent of the path joining any two points a and b in R. In diagram, let this is my region R where fz is analytic, and let us consider I have a point a somewhere like at this position and say another point b which is lying at this position. So this is my A, this is my B. Then the proposition says that it doesn't matter in which path, along which path you are doing this integration from A to B, FZ, DZ, the answer will be same. Means if I consider, say I'm considering this path and I am considering say some path which is like this. Now, if this path is named as C1 from A to B, and this is, say, C2 from A to B, then we have to prove that integration of FZ DZ along C1 is equal to integration of FZ DZ along C2. So we have to prove this. Can you prove it? Of course, you can prove it. It's pretty simple. It's just an application of Cauchy-Gaussert theorem. Now, by Cauchy-Gaussert theorem, since the region is simply connected, actually here we can apply the version of Cauchy-Gaussert theorem for simply connected regions. Now, if I consider integration of fz dz along C1 plus minus of integration of fz dz along C2, can you tell me what will be the answer? The answer is equal to zero, because minus of integration fz dz along C2 means I am traversing from B to A along this in this way. That means I'm considering this particular simple closed curve which can be drawn in this way. I'm considering a simple closed curve this. Therefore, This implies that integration of fz dz along c1 is equal to integration of fz dz along c2, and that is equal to integration along a to b fz dz. Now, since c1 and c2 had been chosen arbitrarily, we can say that this is true for any path joining the two points a and b. That means the result of this integration is independent of the path chosen for traversing from a to b. So that is how we can simply prove this proposition. Now, the second proposition, which is even more important, is integration of 1 by z minus a dz along c is equal to twice pi I, where c is any simple closed curve and z equals to a is inside c. Now, you can understand that the z equals to a is a singular point of the integrand 1 by z minus a. If it lies outside the curve C, we could have simply said by Cauchy-Gaussert theorem that the answer will be 0. But here, the z equals to a is lying inside C, and we can see here that the result or the answer for this integration will be twice pi I. Now, the question is how we can prove this. Okay. The proof is very simple. Let us consider C as per the following diagram. This is my simple closed curve C, and let us consider Z equals to A inside C is lying somewhere like this position. So this is my Z equals to A. Now let us consider a small a circle gamma of radius epsilon with center at z equals to a inside this C, which looks something like this. Let this gamma is traversed in positive sense relative to its interior. That means in this way. Now, by the proposition that we have proved above, we can say that integration of 1 by z minus a dz along c is equal to integration of 1 by z minus a dz along gamma. Now, this gamma is a circle of radius epsilon centered at a. So, this gamma can be defined as z minus a is equal to epsilon e to the power I theta, where 0 less than or equal to theta less than 2 pi. That is, we can write z is equal to a plus epsilon e to the power I theta, which implies dz is equal to I epsilon e to the power I theta. Now, if we plug in this, let us call this equation number one. So, if we plug in these values in equation number one, what do we get? We get integration dz by z minus a along this curve C is equal to integration dz is I epsilon e to the power I theta. Oh, I missed d theta here. It should be d theta. Sorry. So d theta divided by z minus a is epsilon e to the power I theta, and theta varies from 0 to twice pi. So I can write here theta equals to 0 to theta equals to twice pi. Fine. So this now epsilon gets cancelled. So okay, e to the power I theta also becomes also gets cancelled. So this is equal to I into integral theta equals to 0 to theta equals to twice pi d theta. That means I into twice pi, that is twice pi I, hence proved. So this you can find later that this will be extremely useful result. We will use this in so many places in our further course of development of this subject. And in the next tutorial or in the next class, we will discuss about Cauchy's integral formula, and this result will be an integral part of that formula. See you in the next video. Take care.